Robin Ince, who joins me now. You look skeptical.
No, I think Florence the Machine will be very, very good. I heard she was very good at Glastonbury. I didn't see her at Glastonbury because I'm an old man, and it would be the equivalent of looking through chicken wire fence, as far as I'm concerned. I'm only allowed to go to things like the jazz stage nowadays.
So you're old and curmudgeonly.
No, I'm not curmudgeonly. I think some of the young people's music is very exciting and very interesting. Not as good as what we had in 1981, of course. But I mean, I actually love festivals. That's the proof that I'm not a curmudgeon. And it's beautiful here at Latitude today because this is the last day you can be downwind of the toilets and still smell oak trees. And from tomorrow, it would just occasionally just pick it up when you go. The piquancy of a certain form of cider urine is fascinating.
I think Florence is genuinely like a great festival performer. Mm. It's a weird thing. I like the records and I love it when you see her live. I don't know that if you ever see her live on the television or if you hear the tracks live on the radio, it really captures it. There's some kind of disconnect between
Well, I think
the
that's true
things.
Of any music on television, the same as stand-up on television. It's never going to be... It's ultimately a live medium. Mm. And you're right as well about festival bands. There are bands that are absolutely fantastic, bands that I like a great deal, but as festival bands, after 20 minutes ago, I'm bored. One of the best things I ever saw was Fun Loving Criminals. I'm not a huge fan of Fun Loving Criminals, but back in about 1997, or it might have been 1999 at Glastonbury, they did, I think they were the penultimate act on, and they were just absolutely fantastic. They stopped for 15 minutes and did a sketch inspired by the film Scarface. And the whole of the main stage, the whole of the Pyramid stage field was laughing. Yeah. And that's an impressive thing to do.
You are a veteran of Latitude. This isn't your first time, is it? How many years have you done this?
I've done every single one. So I think it was 4 years ago was the first one. And that was... I had this fantastic thing 4 years ago where Anthony and the Johnsons were on. Mm-hmm. And Anthony then started to go that he was rather surprised when he found out that Jimmy Cranky was actually a woman. And there's something fantastic. I know that, in fact, he did live in the UK for a while, but you still, when you hear these fantastic, beautiful, you know, torch songs that he comes out with, you don't expect somewhere after one of the songs to go, Jimmy Cranky is a little woman and married? Very weird. I don't know if that's how he sounds. That's just my generic, you know, Lower East Side torch song I'm playing in the basement voice.
It's good. You had me at Jimmy Cranky.
And last year, I've got to say, last year I took Sunday afternoon off because I try and gig a lot, but last seeing the Vaseline's magazine and then Nick Cave in 5 hours was fantastic.
I know you're taking it easy this weekend. How many times will you be performing here at Latitude?
I think I'm only doing about 12 this time. So it 12? Should be... the thing I am most looking forward to is last year with the brilliant musician Robin Hitchcock, we made up a musical about giant killer crabs. I've recently written a book, part of which is about giant killer crabs.
What is it that interests you specifically about giant killer crabs?
Guy N. Smith, who wrote Crabs on the Rampage, Crabs Moon, Killer Crabs, The Origin of the Crabs. Hey, you know the title.
Of course, these are the books that people are taking on holiday.
These are, if you're going to Barmouth, because many of them are based around Barmouth, it's that you think, what could go wrong with a rural idyll of a Welsh coast holiday, and then one thing leads to another, the crustaceans attack. And the great thing is, in the book where I describe its author as being what Mills and Boone is to romance, Guy N. Smith is to dismemberment. And Robin Hitchcock loves them as well. So we put on an impromptu musical about 1 a.m. And we found a violinist and opera singer and a trumpet player. And this time on Saturday night at about 1 a.m, I think we're going to have about 70 musicians. And I hope that we're going to end up surrounding the whole of the literary stage with musicians to just create, and opera singers, to just create this cacophony as the crabs attack. Possibly during the Radio 1 roadshow, which happens in Crab's Moon. There's a beautiful bit where, I hate the Radio 1 roadshow. Why don't we go swimming instead? What, even though we're adulterers? Yeah, even though we're adulterers, I can't imagine anything will go wrong. Oh, no. The crabs have shown their morality. And that's what I love about Latitude. I think there are a few festivals like this, but not many, where you can... I've got so many different performers that I'm working with over the weekend that we can just come up with something absolutely ridiculous. I mean, I think I told you once about a friend of mine, Wayne Shepherd, does this brilliant character called Gary Lestrange, and he had a song called Maggots, 5 minutes of which was just him going, maggots, maggots. He actually said to me, do you think that's too long? I went, no, too short, too short. And I managed to build up a chorus of 40 people, including Ian Hart, the actor, of course, you know, played John Lennon and was in the End of the Affair and many other great things. Yep. And also James Franco from Milk and the Spider-Man movies. And James Franco just walked off and he went, hey, you guys are weird. But he meant it in a complimentary manner.
And just something like, I've not got much time, but just when I used to go to festivals first in the early 90s, the comedy tent was always a bear pit. Mm. Is it less like that now, especially at something like Latitude? Is it completely different to how it used to be?
It's a fantastic place to watch comedy. I mean, there's so many different tents around, and there's burlesque and there's cabaret, and there's I mean, that's one of the things that I really love about Latitude, is there's a proper variety. And people will say this as well. I mean, comedy now, I've played the comedy tent here a few times, and Glastonbury in 1997, I had people charging the stage. I'm sure I've told the story before, being attacked by a Klingon whose forehead fell off halfway through the attack and then had to scamper away in shame.
It does ring a bell.
It's my old Klingon forage routine, which I always drag out. And you don't see that kind of thing. There's still, I mean, when I'm doing my Giant Crabs musical at 2 a.m, there is the possibility that something will go awry.
Yeah.
Yes. But it is, and it's like people now go, oh, they're so middle-class festivals nowadays. You think, well, do you know what? They always were quite middle-class. I always think that people say Latitude is the most middle-class festival. I think it's the only one where people feel they don't have to put on a Cockney accent when they're wandering around. You know, that's.
But also, I think it's lovely if you've been to a lot of festivals and you're a little bit sick of seeing big banners for Carlsberg or Budweiser everywhere. The festivals like Latitude are a complete antidote to that as well.
Well, that's, I always find that annoying, where you know, you're, the only beer you can buy is whoever the ghastly sponsor is.
Yes.
Who is the ghastly sponsor for this? Do we know?
Robin, I'll let you go and prepare for one of your...
No, I want to take the man down. Let's go anti-corporate. Who owns Absolute Radio? The revolution lasts till Sunday. It won't be televised, but it might be broadcast.
Certainly podcast. Robin Ince, thank you so much for talking to us.